Good morning, everybody. I'm Paul Lisnick.
And I'm Tamon Bradley. This is WGN-TV Political Report.
The COVID-19 pandemic continues to keep much of Illinois and the nation at home and out of work. New numbers show the U.S. unemployment rate has skyrocketed to 14.7%. That is the highest rate since the Great Depression. In Illinois, more than 74,000 unemployment claims were filed last week. Governor J.B. Pritzker saying the state has now processed more than 1 million claims from March through May 2nd.
And while many Americans are still waiting for their federal stimulus checks, Congress is debating their next round of bailout money. House Democrats say the package could include another $750 billion in aid to some state and local governments. And there could also be even more direct support for struggling Americans. But there is still no consensus on how Congress can safely return to Washington. Lawmakers have been unable to find a bipartisan agreement on changing the rules to allow remote voting. It would be a first in the chamber's 230-year history. Republicans have called on Speaker Pelosi to create a plan that includes social distancing and would allow a full return to Washington before any new spending bills are passed.
Starbucks proves every day they can work. The Senate proves they can work. Why is the only place in the Capitol that cannot work is the House?
And Democratic Congressman Mike Quigley from Illinois' 5th District joins us this morning to talk about that and more. Congressman, welcome back to the show. Good to see you.
Good to see you. Thank you.
So President Trump has said we can't keep the country closed for 5 years, his words. People are going to die, but it's a risk we need to take. When you look at an unemployment rate now, the highest since the Great Depression, does he have a point?
Look, there's a balance to be played in all of these measures. We somehow have to adjust this so that we can move forward. But it has to be based on facts. It has to be based on science and good medicine. And the fact of the matter is we are simply not ready. Even the Republicans in the Senate are pushing back on the president and the fact that we need much more testing before we go forward. We've been flying blind from day one on this crisis. And without sufficient testing, we're putting people needlessly at risk as we begin to open up again.
Congressman, forecasters expect the unemployment rate to remain elevated for years to come. Are we in for a decade of cuts to benefits and flat wages?
Look, I think we're in for a long haul here in terms of the economic devastation that this country is going to face. The CARES Act had a good first step toward that end. We expanded and extended unemployment benefits for all Americans, an additional $600 per week. Then there were the stimulus checks. Then there was the most important thing we did was $150 billion for hospitals, another $75 billion in the second CARES package, because we're talking about the economy. But this is, first and foremost, a public health crisis. If you want to solve the economic crisis that comes from that public health crisis, we've got to get a handle on the virus. We've got to develop a vaccine, and we have to perfect its treatment while we are protecting the most vulnerable in our society.
Well, Congressman, this is indeed a health crisis, and so let's take a look and talk about health care for a moment. People are losing their jobs. They're also losing their health care. President Trump's administration reaffirming that it will continue to argue in the Texas courts that the Affordable Care Act should be found to be unconstitutional. Question is, what do you say to people in your district and our state who are losing their health care and may not have the Affordable Health Care Act to turn to?
Look, I think what the virus has done, and never waste a crisis, is it's helped reaffirm in our country the need that everyone have access to health care. Now, I voted for Obamacare, 11 years now? And we're continuing to learn just how important it is, and the virus stresses that measure. So we need to be more prepared, and we need to make sure everyone has access to the care necessary to meet any crisis we face.
There's a lot of hope surrounding remdesivir. It's shown to be effective in speeding up recovery from COVID-19. But a federal trial found that the drug did not increase the death rate in 100 patients. What do you know about finding a treatment? Where are we?
We are a long way from having a long-term solution to this problem. This virus has more questions than answers at this point in time. That's why we need to be more prepared. This is, the third such crisis in the last 16 years, obviously the most severe. And we need to expand the research and the coordination and communication internationally, nationally, and locally as well. So the research that needs to go into something like this has a ways to go, especially when it comes to a vaccine. So I don't think it pays to sugarcoat this matter and tell people and give them some sort of false hope. If we found a vaccine we knew would work today, it would still require, even with some shortcuts, extensive testing and mass production. You're not talking about a million or a couple million. You're talking about billions of doses that are going to be necessary to keep everyone safe.
Well, Congressman, this is an ongoing and long-term issue. So let me ask you quickly about the coronavirus task force. Tuesday of this past week, the president said it's going to get disbanded. By Wednesday, he said actually he didn't realize how popular it was, and he wants to keep it around. Is there a role for the task force? Who should we be hearing from?
Look, it isn't a question of how popular it is, what kind of ratings it gets, it's how effective it is. And frankly, we need a task force that's far more effective than the existing process. We need better coordination. This crisis screams for a coordinated public health program with teeth across the whole country, communicating, improving testing, improving access to protective equipment, and making sure that we're not flying blind as we have from day one of this crisis.
Congressman, we need to get to a commercial break in about 45 seconds, but I did want to ask you, we learned this week that United Airlines is gearing up for layoffs coming up in October. Do you think that the staff reductions that they've talked about violate the spirit of that airline rescue package that Congress passed?
You know, we went back to Washington, D.C. I think it was a $50 billion package for the airlines. With that comes commensurate responsibility on all businesses that were helped, including the airlines. We understand how critical they are to our nation's commerce, but they have to respect the fact that those are hard-earned tax dollars meant to maintain that airline and its employment. And what any airline or business does that's contrary to that, it needs to be looked at and handled responsibly.
All right, Congressman, stay with us. We're going to take our first break. Coming up next, a closer look at the issues beyond the coronavirus headlines and how Congress is already eyeing the November election. Plus,
wreaked upon our economy, the economy of the United States and that of the world, is mind-boggling.
Our state cannot survive this way.
The debate over Governor Pritzker's plan to reopen the state, why some small towns say they shouldn't be held back. Stay with us.